You listen to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. Yes, I've got a new camera. I'm very excited about it. It's in HD again. I was in a cave for like a couple of weeks because my old camera broke and I had to use an old one. It looked awful. I mean, I don't look great now, but it looked awful then. I am joined on this episode, something a little bit different. I've interviewed wrestlers, I've interviewed managers, I've interviewed ring announcers. But for the first time, I think, about 300 episodes, they all get a bit fuzzy in the end. I'm joined by an interviewer, ICW's own Weir Whipley herself. It is Katt Wolfe. Welcome to the show.
I feel honoured to be the first interviewer. I didn't know that. That's fun.
It's just one of those things. Like, I think it's an underrated thing. I mean, I've only recently gotten brave enough to actually do like interviews with wrestlers face to face and just get like wee snippets. And you know what? It's bloody nerve wracking, to be honest. It's just like
it's hard work.
And it's like you're hoping that they're on the same page as you when you're asking a question. And I did commentary recently, or tried commentary recently, and I thought, geez, all these jobs that you think in your head, oh, this is gonna be a bit easy. No, not the slightest. They're just every job.
I think I'd rather do anything other than commentary.
Well, it was one of those things where I don't know if you would have the opinion as well, but I was watching some show and I heard the commentary. And I thought, I can do better than that. That's terrible. I could do that. And then I loaded that up. I thought, no, this is awful. This is terrible. What am I doing? This wasn't so bad, actually. That guy was okay. I don't know if you ever get the same thing when you're watching interviewers when they're maybe over or under, and you're just watching, just going, I could probably do. I could get what I needed out of that wrestler with if I did it, you know.
Not too often, to be honest, because you never know what the person's like. cultivated art form that we have.
It is weird. I don't know. I mean, we'll get into it with the many wrestlers you've had the microphone in front of, but yeah, for being briefly backstage at shows, you see them in the ring and they're terrified, and they come back and they're really nice, or it's vice versa. You're like, I don't understand wrestling. It's too complicated. And I've watched it for like 25 years. I still don't get it. And it's the same thing with speaking to wrestlers. It's like, if I ever meet a wrestler in the daylight, I still call them the wrestler name. I refuse to call it. I don't need to know. I don't want to know your real name.
I don't want to know.
I don't want. And the ones when they pop up on your Facebook and go, do you want to add so-and-so? I don't know who that is. That's so-and-so. Anyway, this isn't me having like I say, I've been on the go for like 4 days. So I'm just like, I think I'm overexcited, to be honest. So I apologize in advance if I just start tailing off and rambling. But we're speaking to Katt Wolfe, ICW's own. We're just going to have a good natter. So, wrestling. How did you get involved with we'll just dive straight in and we'll work around from there. So how did you end up getting involved with ICW?
So, I don't know if you'll remember way back when there used to be a kind of cabaret. So sorry. That was Fonio. Start that sentence again. I don't know if you remember back in the day, there used to be a cabaret kind of dark circus thing called Cirque Noir in Glasgow. And basically it was run by a woman called Rachel Atlas, very fantastic, wonderful performer. And I used to work those shows. It was where I started out doing performing work. I have a background in like burlesque and modeling and doing walkabout acts and things like that. So I've always been quite confident, but we had quite a bit of crossover there with ICW, and that I believe Jester used to come along and do those shows and performed in one of them. And so kind of got to know people through that. And then that's how I met Veronica as well. Me and Veronica hit it off like house on fire. We're very similar. We just get it. We get each other. And yeah, when the position came up, she was asked to think of people who might be suitable, and she knows I'm a yapper and that I know how to be in front of a camera and kind of do all of that fun stuff. And yeah, I was offered a trial, so I was very lucky.
When it comes to performing then, so that's a very important thing, of course, because you're in front of camera, you have to hold the attention of the audience, and nowadays it has to be done quickly and snappy because we've all got phones and we all wander off on TikTok. But yeah, is that always something that you've been quite adept at? That's not the word. Adept at? That's not the word either.
I think so,
but,
yeah.
Yeah, performing.
I know what anyway. You mean. I've been modeling now for 12 years. I actually initially, before I got into modeling, I used to do cosplay. And I just really enjoyed dressing up and doing comic cons. I used to enter the competitions. And it was how I built a lot of my confidence, because prior to that, I was bullied a lot at school and had no self-esteem. I was very, very shy. I thought I was the ugliest person in the world, basically. And then got into cosplay and I was like, oh, right, okay, actually I'm not as bad as, okay. And then as I got older, I was like, no, actually I'm okay. I'm not terrible. And just found out that through cosplaying and kind of doing photo shoots, I had a knack for posing and I learned how to model. So I got into the modeling route, and obviously when you model, you usually end up having to do stuff for camera. So throughout doing that, I quickly kind of learned the tips and tricks and, you know, how to really look down a lens and just worked out my best angles and facial expressions and things like that. And it's actually something really small that I think a lot of people don't really realize, and that you kind of have to know your face really well to know what faces you're doing at cameras and things like that when you are working and recording. If you want to look your best anyway, I'm sure you can do it natural and not be as worried about how you're looking. But yeah, when you're wanting to look your best and feel your best in front of a camera, you definitely have to learn how to really do that. And I was really, really lucky to have had that modeling base that kind of gave me the platform to grow from there, really.
So I don't want to focus on the bullying side of things, but did you find that the cosplay and that you're able to transform yourself into a bit more of a character? I suppose that's quite very wrestling based as well. That once you're
100%, yeah, totally,
yeah,
absolutely. I love characters. I just enjoy, like, yeah, being a different character. So yeah, like it started as an escapism thing, in that I just was very, very unhappy, and wanted to kind of escape my typical school life and home life and things like that. And I could transform into this character, and I wasn't her anymore. I was this character. And so yeah, it was quite a nice, like, kind of bit of escapism. And I guess it's just more that's kind of evolved and now turned into this other little niche hobby. I've come from like various niche communities.
You're in Scottish wrestling, which is the nichest of the niche of the whole wrestling fandom as well. Which
are we that niche anymore? I don't know.
It goes in and out, it seems.
It does, yeah.
I mean, I've done like near 300 podcasts about it, so I don't know how niche I find it now, because I've known maybe far too much about people.
I guess that's it. Yeah, we're absorbed in it. So is it niche if we're, you know, directly in the middle of it?
That's it. Unless you start mentioning names to people, they kind of go glassy eyed. You go, it's still a bit niche. It's still not all there. So I'm probably going to make myself look stupid here, but what was your fandom niche then for cosplaying?
In terms of like what animes and stuff I liked, or.
Yeah, I know I've went down a hole that I'm not going to be able to be able to answer follow-up questions about, but I know other people will be interested. So what was your anime, your anime genre? Is that the right thing to say about it?
I guess, I'll give you my top three animes. How's that? At the time, this was then, not now, just to clarify, because this was like what, we're talking maybe like a good 15 years ago, if not longer. At the time, I was a big Helsing fan. I loved Oren High School Host Club. And if I had to pick a third, it would probably just be Naruto. I was a Naruto kid. And we've covered like all three genres there because we've done ninjas, a very strange girly host club themed anime, and then Hellsing, which is just a bloodbath. I guess that sums me up, really.
Well, I don't feel so silly because I've heard of Naruto. Oh my god, I don't know why I said it like that. Naruto, I've heard of that. The third one.
Naruto.
Yeah, that's the one. But you know, no, I know that seems to be quite a running theme with wrestlers. It seems that anime and Dungeons and Dragons seems to be thrown in there as well. And it's just
I love D&D.
It's two things I know nothing about. I'd always say that I'm going to get into, but never do. But I know that it seems to be there's a big corner. Like maybe not even a corner, maybe a street of Scottish wrestlers are involved in Scottish wrestling that love all that kind of stuff. And again,
a lot more than we realize that love anime and stuff, which is really nice because I'm always like, oh, my worlds are colliding. This is nice. Like I can talk to you about wrestling and anime stuff. Like perfect.
I can't remember who someone said it recently on. Must be on Twitter or social media of some sort, because otherwise, where would I see it? Saying that you need to have a second thing if you're in wrestling, you need to have a second thing you like at least, because nobody wants to speak about wrestling 24/7. If you do, you're a liar. You know, so
that's very true.
So yeah, that seems a lot of it is anime, a lot of it's D&D. Mine's MCU. That's kind of my second thing I like. As you may be able to tell by the wall of crap in the background with Deadpool.
Gave it away, yeah.
The t-shirt would have done it as well. I never thought the t-shirt was
the main giveaway.
I never thought about that when I said that. But yeah, that's the kind of thing that you have to have it because I know for myself, as soon as I mention wrestling to my crowd of friends, as small as it is, you can see their eyes just glaze over and just go, oh, I say speaking about that again. And I go, ah, Spider-Man. Oof, there we go. We're back in a conversation.
Jingle, jingle. Yeah. Come back to the conversation. Jingle, jingle.
I promise I won't talk about wrestling anymore.
Yeah, jingle, jingle. So anyway.
So anyway, Jack Chester. Right. So coming into the Scottish wrestling scene then, it's like I said, we're on the fence whether it's niche or not anymore because we're that into it anyway. But coming into it and going into especially ICW, was it still the pandemic, just at the end of the pandemic stuff where it was closed crowds, or was it actually
After I think we were out of wearing masks when I joined, so yeah, like probably maybe a year after the pandemic. I was lucky enough to kind of miss that phase, because that was just a tough time for everyone, I'm sure. But yeah, no, I came and joined when there was crowds and we kind of had like a typical atmosphere, which was nice because I think that would have been really intimidating if it had been like peak COVID era.
Yeah, especially with the closed doors and all that kind of stuff. It was a tough time for everyone. I mean, I suppose from our very brief chat so far, I think you may have been okay with it because you've got that experience with cameras and all that, and there's a lot of new faces coming in that may not have had that experience anyway. So yeah, back, you came in, crowds were back, you were a new face on the scene for a lot of people, and you were just thrown in straight away, Fight TV, WWE Network, all that kind of stuff.
Yep.
What was first day of the job, what were your thoughts, what were your was there any nerves there, what was your experience?
I was definitely nervous, I was so nervous. I didn't really know what to expect. And I've always been quite doubtful of my talking ability. I know I'm a yapper, I'm a certified yapper, right? I can yap about anything, anytime, anywhere. But it was more making sure that I was yapping about the right things and asking people the right questions. And, you know, also I think something that's not necessarily like known so much as I've got a lot of backstage experience on other shows, but a wrestling dressing room is a very different dressing room to say a burlesque dressing room, or you know, I don't know if you know this, but I also do like mermaid work. I dress up as a mermaid and swim in aquariums, which do performances and things like that. So I have a lot of experience at backstage areas, but there's so many different things that, you know, having to go around and shake everyone's hand, say hi to everyone, that's something that's not typical in those other professional surroundings. So that was quite like a bit of an eye opener to me, because I'm like, oh, I have to like I have to go around everyone and say hi, like, oh God, like I've never met half these people. I was really nervous. But no, I was lucky in that I remember I think Shay Monet was my first interview. And I had already got a great friendship with Shay Monet prior to that, as we'd met and stuff and hung out and become friends. And yeah, so it was nice in that I could interview people that I already had a little bit of, I already knew kind of what they were about. I knew them as a person, and I felt comfortable around them, and that just gave me the confidence to then start to be like, okay, well, I can talk, I can do this. This is fine. Everything is fine. And yeah, and grow from there.
Yeah, I know that kind of feeling when it comes to yeah, trying to stay on top. I mean, I just had a minute there where I couldn't think of the word. I still don't know the word I'm thinking of. But yeah, so it's trying to find that kind of balance where you can ask the right questions and all that kind of stuff. And is there any, do you watch anything for inspiration, that kind of thing? Do you go watch back? I don't know, I'm trying to think ones off the top of my head. Probably Renee Paquette is probably an example, because she's probably one of the premier ones to do it. And being female, that's just a very, very easy one my brain just went to. But yeah, is there any interviewers that you do watch, whether it's wrestling or not, to kind of help you?
I'm trying to think. I guess I like to watch like a really strong variety rather than kind of home in on one person. Like, what's the YouTube channel called? There's a Northern Irish guy on YouTube that makes wrestling videos, and he does like, what's he called? He does Reliving the War. Do you know the guy I mean?
Oh, I don't, but I'm gonna.
Oh, what's he called? He has a whole amazing YouTube channel that has like so many different compilations of snippets on different people at different times, and like you can just find so much information on his channel, and that's kind of where I go when I'm feeling a little bit uninspired, but I can't remember the name and I feel so bad.
Is it Wrestling Bios?
Yes, Wrestling Bios. That has been like an amazing resource for me for just going and like, I don't know, just binge watching things basically and trying to absorb information. But I don't like to really kind of home in on one person, just because I don't want to like mimic their style or copy somebody. I feel like if I have like a really varied base of different people that I've watched, then I'm like, oh, I like that thing from that person, I'll pull that, or I like this from them and I'll kind of take inspiration there. And that can be whether it's wrestling or non-wrestling interviewers as well. Yeah, like that's kind of how I kind of roll. I'll just do a lot of really broad market research. And then also, I'm obviously completely blessed to be working with Veronica, who's been an amazing teacher. So much, just, you know, years and years of knowledge and experience. And yeah, she's taught me so much. She's been amazing.
I feel like I skipped over very too quickly about the mermaid thing. because... Yeah. Because yeah, I did a little bit of research and I was seeing that. Basically, I scrolled your Instagram, and that's kind of how most of my research works for everyone nowadays, because it's the easiest thing to
it's
do.
There. Yeah.
Yeah. It's all there. How do you get involved in something like that? Because it's fascinating to watch.
I guess it's like another, I guess it's just another thing, like, similar to wrestling, I guess, in that, you know, how you need your other hobbies. I started it because I wanted a fun, stupid way to lose weight. And then I took a freediving course because I love swimming. I love being in the ocean and stuff. Took a freediving course because I wanted to hold my breath for longer. And I like extreme sports as well. Like I love extreme sports in general. So I was like, cool, I'm going to hold my breath and do that. And I just so happened to choose a course with the guy who owns the mermaid agency in the UK. And he's like, oh, you're quite good at this. You're quite relaxed underwater. You don't, some people kind of do it and they have like the puffed up cheeks, like a big puffer fish, and they hold all the air in their face and they look like they're drowning basically. I mean, you are drowning professionally. But yeah, I don't look like I'm drowning. I'm very lucky in that I can hide what is going on. And yeah, he was like, well, if you keep training, I'll give you a job. And I was just very lucky. Funnily enough, actually, I most people know this, that my partner is Rabu. When we first met, one of the ways that we actually really clicked was that we were discussing pro wrestling and I was discussing mermaiding, and we found out that there's actually an insane amount of crossover, to the point that now a lot of the UK mermaids that I work with use wrestling language to describe mermaid things. So like, we'll talk about like, you know, like you'll go underwater and you can hear the kids screaming sometimes when you do tricks. So like, I'll go under and I'll do a spin off the window and then into a backflip, and then I'll come out and blow a big bubble kiss, and I'll come up like, oh man, you guys should have heard the pop I got. And it's like, it's so funny to us. But yeah, there's a lot of crossover between mermaiding and pro wrestling. You'd be shocked. It's quite impressive, actually.
Well, I know what I'm doing this evening now. I'm just going to be watching mermaiding videos and just because, yeah, when Tuesday, I was like, all right, cool. But I suppose you say that you look calm under pressure, I suppose, that all that training that you've had anyway about looking in the camera, it's just, is that something that's probably one of your biggest strengths? That's a terrible question I'm going with. It's one of your biggest strengths, so you're able to look calm under pressure and able to kind of let all that kind of bubble up inside a little bit and just while the camera's on.
I think so, yeah. Like, it's one of those things where I guess I've trained to the point where, you know, you are under this immense pressure, but you can slap a smile on and look like you're calm and collected and everything is fine. And I guess, yeah, it's just, you know, I guess it is a talent of mine that I've somehow found, but you know, if it works, it works. I think there's been a lot of transferable skills from my mermaiding work into like the pro wrestling scene. Just in that, obviously, if I can, in fact, funnily enough, when when I spoke to Mark Dallas for the first time, oh, this is so embarrassing, but it's so funny now to think back on. The first time I spoke to Dallas, I'd had my trial and Veronica was like, you've done great. Like, we really loved you. And Dallas kind of asked me like, oh, how did you get on stage? Did you enjoy yourself? And then he's like, what kind of experience do you have? And I don't know why I completely forgot about every bit of relevant experience I've ever had. And something just came out and I was like, oh, well, I'm a mermaid and I can like hold my breath for like a minute and a half. So, you know, like I'm really good in high pressure situations. But I think something about that just added to my overall charm. I don't think anyone's ever gone up to me and probably said that before. So yeah, you know, it obviously worked. I got the job.
But I bet you're glad you added the second bit. If you just went, have you got any experience? Yeah, I'm a mermaid. I think that probably would went nuts. Let's usher her out the door, please.
Yeah, I don't know. I just don't know where it came from. I don't know why that's what I went to. And even now, we'll still joke about it and be like, hi, Dallas, I'm a mermaid. It keeps me up at night, you know, when you're laying in bed thinking about all those embarrassing things. That's definitely one that crops up quite often.
I've got plenty. I this is why I like doing interviews this way, because I'm the same. If I meet wrestlers, I just somehow switch off my brain and just start talking absolute nonsense. And
it's funny, I'm not normally like that, but I think because I was under, like, I was so, like, worked up the whole day and I'd been putting a face on the whole day and, like, holding it together the whole day. And then this was, like, the final thing. And then it's just, like, what experience do you have? And my brain just stopped working. It was, like, a little loading screen in the middle. And I'm just like, I'm a mermaid. Yeah, let's go with that.
I mean, my go-to for that is always when I met Lita. And mm-hmm. I'm a humongous heart. I was a Team Extreme fan for life. And mm-hmm. Just to make you feel better when I tell the story, because I've said it many times on this podcast. But yeah, when I met her, I was wearing a Hardy Boys t-shirt. And she went, oh, great t-shirt. And I didn't think she'd ask me any questions. I was not prepared for this. And I went, oh, cool. Yeah, I was looking for your one on eBay, but I couldn't find one. And then I thought, why have I said this? This is awful. And then I gave her a book to sign, and she went, oh, do you want me to sign your name in it? And I went, yeah, sign, my name's Billy. It's okay, I'm not going to sell it. And that's why I don't like meeting good wrestlers, because I just go, my brain switches off, and it just goes autopilot. Yeah. Every thought is coming out of your mouth now, and that's just, so, Zoom's safer.
It's a scary place to be in.
It's terrifying. There's too many thoughts. They need to mm-hmm. all just go somewhere. Unfortunately, when I meet wrestlers, it's out the mouth. But yeah, so
luckily I've got a good rap on that.
I know, I'm meeting Gangrel at the weekend. I know it's going to go wrong. I'm going to say something stupid, and it's just going to be a terrible moment for me. But you know, it'll make someone laugh. That's the most important thing, I suppose.
There you go.
In this line of work. I didn't think we'd spend that much time talking about mermaids. I don't think you'd thought we'd spend that much time speaking about mermaids.
I didn't actually know.
No. So we'll move back into the wrestling world a little bit. So you're in now, ICW, and I was noticing that you've now jack of all trades a little bit in wrestling ever since. I've noticed ring announcing, I think, for Aaron Girders and Blockbuster. I think you've done it for Blockbuster.
Not Blockbuster, no.
Well, my notes have been terrible already. But yeah, so so is that just... That seems like, from this brief chat we were having, that just seems like you're all over. If you're in something, you're in. You want to at least learn as much as you possibly can of the things you can do. How is ring announcing for you then?
Terrifying. Absolutely terrifying. It occurred to me maybe like a day before that actually... although I watch a lot of wrestling, I don't listen to ring announcers. And that's a terrible thing to admit. Simon's listening. I'm so sorry, Simon. But I guess I do listen, but I don't really like absorb the knowledge because I'm like, this is temporary knowledge. I only need to know like maybe one or two parts of what you're saying, like what kind of match is it, you know, stipulations. And then that information kind of leaves my brain. So when I came to do it, I was like, oh God, I'm so unprepared for this. Like, I have no idea. And totally panicked. And funnily enough, I was just about to go out, and I was kind of about like 5 minutes before I kind of went out. And Kez walked past me, and Kez is like, "Kat, you're going to need to fix your face." And I'm like, "Just let me have 5 minutes. The doors are closed and no one can see me. As soon as I go out the curtains, the face will turn on. But like, I'm just having a 5 minutes, like, give me peace." And he's like, "Okay, as long as it turns, like, as long as your face is okay when you go out there." He's like, "You can't go out looking like that." I'm like, "I'm fully aware. I know, like, it's not going to look like that when I go out. Don't worry." But yeah, and then I went out and it was absolutely fine. And I did all the things I needed to do and everything was grand. And I was like, oh, okay, so okay, I can do this. Is it my favorite thing? Maybe not, but it's good to have another string to my bow. And I just like, you know, when you're given an opportunity to gain more experience, how can I say no? You know, it's one of those.
is there any jobs that you have your eye on? Maybe not replacing someone, but at least jumping in if required. Trying to think of jobs that you could do. I don't know, reffing at wrestling. I don't know. Is there anything that you would like to try at least?
I don't think so. I'm quite happy being just an interviewer for the most part. You know, it's not the easiest position. It's quite like I think people underestimate how busy we are. It is a very busy role. But I do enjoy the work that we do, and I enjoy kind of, you know, speaking to people and, you know, the final product. I enjoy watching it back and stuff. So yeah, like right now I don't think so, but you know, if an opportunity arises, I'm very much a person to be like, well, if this has fallen into my path, am I gonna say no? Probably not. So yeah, who knows.
So I think we've talked about things like dropping into your path. Let's go back. I think it was Halloween, maybe, right about then. Might have been even later than that. Wea Whipley.
The debut of Wea Whipley. That was Halloween. Yeah. Yep.
That didn't feel like it was that long ago, to be honest. And probably for yourself and your Instagram,
it really didn't actually, yeah.
Instagram comments, it probably didn't feel that long ago either. When they keep...
They're still going.
Yeah. that caused quite a stir, doesn't it?
It really did. And I think the worst part about it is that I know that the Rhea Ripley has seen it. And I'm low-key mortified because I love Rhea Ripley. I'm sure many people do, but I am part of the Rhea Ripley fan club. I am a Rhea Ripley stan. Literally would die for Rhea Ripley. Love her so much. I know she saw at Halloween, she actually shared my post. I think she shared two of my posts and had liked them. And funnily enough, I definitely fangirled, but I fangirled more because prior to that, I used to work for a gothic clothing company called Killstar, and I used to model for them as well, and Rhea follows them. And so obviously because I follow her and I interact with her stuff a lot, when she's liked something, it comes up first her name and then it'll be like, and so many others. And when I was checking on some of the Killstar stuff that I'd worked on, it said Rhea Ripley likes this post and others. And I'm just like, she knows who I am. She knows I exist. So I was like losing my mind initially at that. So I probably had some level of street cred being like, oh, that's that Killstar model. Gone. Absolutely gone. Rhea Ripley ruined everything.
Was that... Go for it.
So I was just going to say, when I did it at Halloween, it was just a wee joke. Like,
a wee joke?
I was like, well, yeah, literally. Yeah, I just thought, you know what, my hair is perfect to dress up as her right now. I wanted to do something funny for the Halloween Gurdjieff show. And I'm also a Halloween girly. Like, I love Halloween and live for Halloween. So I have a Halloween, when I have Halloween, I have like 3-day Halloween extravaganza. And every day is a different costume. And I did that this Halloween. I did Karlach from Baldur's Gate 3 on one day. I did Rhea Ripley. And then I went as the Undertaker another day. So yeah, I had 3 different costumes. That just happened to be one of them because I also didn't really need to get anything. I had everything. So it was like, this is a really easy, comfortable costume. And then, yeah, thought, oh, you know what, while I'm dressed up, I'll make some videos. And it was all downhill or uphill from there, depending on how you see it.
I was going to say, is that when you found out how, like, kind of weird, I suppose, how kind of everything's one extreme or the other when it comes to wrestling fans? Where either your comments are going to be amazing, I love this, or terrible, I hate you.
It was yeah, it was an eye opener, that's for sure. I don't think I've ever had such condensed hate before. Like I've had, you know, nasty comments on videos. I had nasty comments in person. And I was like growing up, getting bullied and stuff. Like very much, everything's kind of water off a duck's back at this point. You can say what you want to say. I've heard it before. It really doesn't get to me much anymore. But that was quite overwhelming. To the point I'm just like, I kind of want to turn Instagram off. And I actually, it was during that time where I changed a lot of my settings on Instagram to just not see a lot of it. So I feel a bit bad because I always miss people messaging me or commenting, but I just really cannot have those notifications going all the time, because it is a bit of a cesspit. People are still commenting on the initial October Rhea Ripley video as well. And that was when I did like the initial like stomp transition video. And I think the top comment is still, is there something wrong with her? She looks disabled. So yeah, that's really nice. I think what they're not taking into account is that I'm trying to do it in a small room and there wasn't much room. So I'm obviously not sending it. But you know, because it wasn't perfect, exactly like Rhea's stomp, they were just like, and really getting at me on it. So yeah. But there was a lot of positive. There was a hell of a lot of positive as well. So, I can't complain. I think from that initial transition reel, I gained about 20,000 followers, which is nuts, you know, like absolutely nuts. So, yeah.
I think my brain's still a little bit broken by that comment of like, people are too brave on the internet nowadays. I mean, I'm barely negative about anything because I'm still afraid people turn up to my house. They don't know where I live, but you know, they could know. It's probably forgotten in the annals of wrestling time now, but there was once a wrestler, a promoter that had Chris Masters turn up at someone's door because they were pirating their shows. And that just haunts me forever. It's not even on the internet anymore, but I still think one day my wife would be very happy if Chris Masters turned up at my front door. But, you know, there's still a moment where I'm going to open the door and it's going to be a wrestler going, you've said nasty things about me. I'm like, I'm so sorry.
How dare you?
I felt brave. So that's kind of answered Heavy Metal Human's question on Instagram. Has Rhea seen Ma? Yes. And if she has, what does she think? I suppose that's a thing you probably never want the answer to. You just want to know that she has seen it.
Well, so this is the thing. So she saw October Halloween, We Are Whipley. But then We Are Whipley made a comeback for the ICW Great Glasgow Bash show, where, you know, we were all, everything was on its head. We were in topsy-turvy land. And unfortunately, Katt Wolfe couldn't make the show, but We Are Whipley could. So, like, it was a it was so fun to do. Like, it really, really was. It was an absolute buzz. Like, I did really enjoy it. And I knew what was coming. I knew there was going to be so many hateful comments. So it was a bit more like mentally prepared. But yeah, so I know that Rhea initially saw We Are Whipley and shared it and appreciated it. And I think this is just from what I've gathered, so I could be wrong. I think Rhea appreciates like genuine cosplays, because obviously I came across like a genuine fan, which I am in general, to be fair. I really am. But I think obviously doing We Are Whipley on a bigger scale like that, and, you know, really selling the wee part of We Are Whipley maybe didn't land me into the cosplay category, and maybe landed me into another category that she maybe doesn't appreciate as much. I'm not sure. But yeah, she's never interacted with anything from We Are Part 2, but We Are Part 1 she liked. So I'm just like, oh no, what have I done? I've screwed it.
Hopefully, I mean, I'll probably end up tagging her in this anyway when I'm doing the old thing on the Twitter machine, so you never know. She might reach out one day.
Hopefully she knows it was just a silly little joke and it was really not serious, and that's very much not how I see women's wrestling or Rhea herself. That it's just me being a goofy little guy, basically. But yeah.
So I'm just double checking these Instagram comments. Lily McLeod, you've answered your question as well, which was what got you into ICW and the interviewing. That was my first question, actually. So look at me, looking in touch with the fan base here.
Yep.
So another question, I'll just close off the Instagram ones with Lilith Sinner. Lilith XS. Ellis Sharp is your actual name. Sweet, that's fine.
Yes.
Easier for me to say.
Love Ellis. Very talented.
Which wrestler would you say has the most unique or coolest tattoos?
Most unique or coolest. Obviously, as we've already covered, I am a Rhea Ripley fangirl, so I love hers. I really like Randy Orton's tattoos, which can be quite a controversial opinion. But yeah, I like how they are, if that makes sense. they're aesthetically pleasing. As far as most unique, it's probably CM Punk with his big, massive Pepsi logo. I say as I'm drinking a Pepsi myself. I do love Pepsi, but I would never be driven to have the Pepsi logo on me in that way. But you know, if that's what makes him happy, then sure, why not? I guess.
I mean, you mentioned Randy Orton, and I think I get what you mean. They are just aesthetically, just they all seem to fit, and they all look kind of they all go together. However,
so
I think
it's neat.
Yeah, he ruined it for himself with that Royal Rumble promo, and I can't remember when it was, one where they do the dating game thing, and he's just there going, that's the skull. And we're watching it back going, yeah, your tattoos are ruined forever, because every time I look at them, I go, that's a skull.
It made it better for me. Honestly, I loved it. And to be fair, I have a version of that where mine is just more, that's a horse, there's another horse. or animals. I have endless animal tattoos on me, so I guess yeah, I can sympathize. There's a lot of skulls as well, so yeah, no, it actually made me like them even more. But I like a well thought out kind of aesthetic kind of tattoo. I worked in the tattoo industry for a while, so I'm a big fan of a really nice, well put together sleeve kind of style design that just kind of flows into itself. CM Punk's tattoos aren't necessarily my cup of tea, but you know, as I said, if that's for you, that's great. It's just not for me.
I can see eventually it will be a sleeve, but it's taken me 10 years to get to this point, so I doubt it'll ever happen. But yeah, mine's not that. It's things I like. There you go. But mostly, to your point with the animals things, there's a Spider-Man one. There's a Spider-Man one. Oh, there's a Spider-Man one.
That's what happens.
It's just that, yeah. So yeah, that's how mine has turned out so far. And it's just a mess. But it's all stuff I like. So.
But it works together. I enjoy it. That's all you need. I must admit, being somebody that's in front of kind of cameras and stuff a lot, I do have to think about my tattoos in quite a different way than some people would maybe think about it, but that's just more down to like me being a bit neurotic and wanting to be very polished all the time. I try and get things done in a certain order so that I'm not having, you know, big unfinished tattoos and stuff that are really visible. I know my back's unfinished, but you know, I think most people can be a little bit lenient with that since it's such a huge piece. But yeah, like kind of getting my arms done and stuff like that. Like I'm trying to make sure that everything's looking all nice and together. We're not looking too patchy. But yeah.
Always baffles me with wrestlers' tattoos when you see them like at the weekend put up, oh, I've got a new tattoo, and then the wrestling on the Monday. I'm like, no, why are you doing that?
It's an actual nightmare. So I used to, I don't know if you're familiar with Terry's, one of Glasgow's oldest, longest running tattoo studios, in Scotland's actually. I used to be a manager there. And so I know quite a decent whack about tattoos, aftercare, you know, designing them, things like that. I really, really love them. I remember when Rabaru got some of his sleeve done and he's like, cool, so I'm wrestling in 2 days. And I'm like, what do you mean you're wrestling in 2 days? No, you're not. No, you can't. And he's like, I am. I have to. And I'm like, okay, well, here's what we're going to do. So, I'm usually the backstage fairy with endless amounts of second skin or Dermaplex in my bag and scissors and wrapping people up, being like, you are not to touch the mat with the fresh tattoo. Please know you're going to get it so infected. Like, and I'll be there. I always say to everyone, if I see somebody getting a tattoo and I know I'm going to be on the same show or I'm going to see them before, I'm like, do you want second skin? Let me give you some Dermaplex. Because it's like, it's used for burn victims actually, but you can use it for tattoos and it just seals them away and locks in everything and keeps everything else out. Because, oh God, I dread to think. I really dread to think.
So it was weird, the joke about Ma and all that kind of stuff with Wea Whipley, but it sounds like you are a little bit of the backstage grown up, I suppose. But I suppose if you're coming into wrestling from a different background, you've been around everything and anything by that point, coming into wrestling, yeah. And seeing how weird it is, and you know, the handshake thing, and I think that's possibly why I've not really excelled in backstage stuff, because I'm like, socially anxious is the best of times, so handshake
is like, tough. I'm pretty socially anxious and I'm always just like, hello.
I will do a high five.
Yeah. Oh, your mid conversation. Hi, I don't want to be seen as rude, but you know, I also have to do the wrestling dance, you know. Yeah, no, it's funny. I guess me and Veronica together are probably our little pair of backstage moas. Like, we've got our little, you know, our little area. People come over and have a chat with us, but then we'll also be like, while they're there, be like, are you okay? You know, do you need this? Do you need that? Or a lot of people know that I always carry, I don't know how to call it. Like, I guess it's like an emergency kit, but it's not necessarily for like a specific emergency. It's just for everything. So like I have deodorant, hairspray, scissors, blister plasters, regular plasters, steri strips, Gaviscon, I've got makeup, I've got, you know, you name it, you name something that you could need something for and I will probably have it in this kit. I usually have a sewing kit with me as well. And if, you know, if a pair of trousers are particularly tight, I have a spare in my bag. But I guess it's just one of those things, and Veronica's probably quite similar in that when you've been performing or been in those scenes for as long as you have, well, even though it's not been specifically wrestling for me, you do just get to a point where you know what it's like when it goes wrong. And so being able to be prepared for when it goes wrong is just the best feeling. And then if it goes wrong for someone else, then you're like, well, this is fine. Look, I've got this, and this, or we can do this, we can do that. And yeah, it's just problem solving on the go. But I like to be helpful, you know?
Speaking of things going wrong, I suppose, maybe not so much going wrong, but of course you do live in-ring things with Billy Kirkwood, who seems to make it his mission to break everyone that's within a couple foot radius of him. What's it like being part of being in that radius of Billy Kirkwood?
How to describe it? I don't know. A touch nerve-wracking because you never know what's going to come out of his mouth. I believe at the last show, Billy referred to me as a roundabout a few times. And then that was a new one. That's like a roundabout. And then he's like kind of like off mic being like, I'm really sorry, I didn't mean to call you a roundabout. And it's like, it's all good. I'm okay. Sure.
I'm more confused than offended at this point.
I think it was because he had walked a circle around me and then called me a roundabout. I was like, I've just used Kat as a roundabout. And I was like, oh, I love being a roundabout. And it just grew arms and legs from there. So yeah, you never know quite what's going to happen. And so, yeah, it's just one of those things. You just got to be ready to go on the fly and, you know, be prepared. There was one, which show was it? One of the live shows before we went live, Billy had made a joke about going to somebody's house for an after party. And then it turned into this, I believe their name was Kai. I believe Kai was getting pumped is what Billy had said. But apparently backstage, everyone thought they were saying Kat. And they were like, oh no, Billy's lost it. And it's like, no, there was somebody called Kai in the audience. We were all on Kai, not Kat, not me. So poor Billy's getting heat backstage, and actually he hadn't done anything wrong at all. He was doing his usual thing of picking on a sweet innocent audience member and choosing their house for an after party and making some jokes. But yeah, people thought they were chanting Kat's getting pumped, which would have been quite funny, but maybe slightly inappropriate.
Halfway writing through the email, you are now sacked, Billy. Yeah, sorry. Yeah. Oh no, it's not. Delete. It's okay.
No, it's all good. It's Kai. The look of relief on people's faces when we kind of cleared that one up quite quickly. But yeah, that was funny. Poor Billy. No, he's a pleasure. He's an absolute pleasure to work with. He is just, yeah, you just never know what's coming.
Yeah, I mean, we've had him on the podcast before, and it was one of the few times where, interestingly, we had to record an hour later because his son had overflown the bath and shorted out the electrics of his house.
Oh no!
And I was like, "That's never happened. I don't think. I hope it never happens again." But it was just like,
our new son is there.
That's a Billy Kirkwood experience if I ever needed
that
one.
Yeah, for a that podcast. Really is.
So last question we've got through the interweb is on Twitter, everyone's favorite place. It's from Ian Skinner.
Oh.
Just the apprehension there. Everyone's probably guessing what it is, but it's not that one. It's what's your favorite part of Monday?
Oh no. It's not the monkeys, Ian. It's anything but the monkeys. Me and Ian Skinner have discussed monkeys at length. A fun, interesting, random fact about me is I don't like monkeys. I'm actually terrified of monkeys, chimps, gorillas, orangutans, marsupials, you name it. I don't like them. And it's not that I dislike them, because I think they're cute. Like squirrel monkeys, whatever they're called, the little boogly eye ones, love them, dead cute. Gorilla programs on the TV, fascinating, love watching them. But I am just scared of anything that's kind of on similar levels of intelligence as us. And I think sometimes monkeys are probably smarter than some people out there. So like, it's almost like an uncanny valley experience. Mm-hmm. And chimps especially, because of the one that ripped the woman's face off, freaked me out a bit. So Ian Skinner likes to communicate in monkey memes sometimes with me, just solely to try and warm me up to Monkey Mondays, which is a regular feature on his social media. And yeah, it's not for me. It's not for me. I'll stick to dogs and horses and cats and things that don't look like they're going to speak back to me in human words. Planet of the Apes is like my worst nightmare. Terrifying.
I'll call off the monkey parade to finish off the show. That's okay. We'll just I'll push it all back.
Perfect.
Just for his own amusement, and a question you've probably been asked more than one occasion by him. Would you rather have unlimited bacon but no more games, or games, unlimited games but no games?
Say that one again.
Okay. Deep breath, because it's quite a mouthful. Would you rather have unlimited bacon but no more games, or games, unlimited games but no games?
So have games, but limited games.
So the first one is, would you rather have unlimited bacon?
But no, it's two separate questions.
Yeah, or games, right. Unlimited games, but no games. So it's an option of two. There's unlimited bacon, but no games, or games, unlimited games, but no games.
Remember how I said I was really good at processing words on the fly? Just cut that part out. So the second option, I get games, but limited games.
Unlimited games, but no games.
How can you have unlimited games, but no games?
See, I still don't know the answer to this question. And Ian introduced this to me about a year and a half ago.
This is such an Ian Skinner question.
It's a meme. It's a bit. It's a thing. Because I found the original tweet. It's from 2021. Because I save it in my bookmarks because I don't know what the question is until I actually have it in front of me. Because it still confuses me. But I'm sure that's probably amused Ian for
that probably has. Minutes. Yeah, he's probably really enjoyed that. So you're welcome.
Yeah, yeah. That and has he approached you for a job for Austin Powers Pro Wrestling yet?
There'll just be monkeys everywhere.
I don't know what he's going to do, to be honest. It'll happen one day, Austin Powers Pro Wrestling, and we'll all be terrified by it. Anyway, right.
It's terrifying.
Less Ian Skinner, more... I don't know what the opposite Ian Skinner would be. We talked about you're trying things and you're happy with what you're doing right now, but is there any itch? I mean, has Rabu at all tried to convince you that do I try some of the wrestling? Have you attempted? Have you thrown a few bumps?
We've had discussions about it. Obviously, like with my background in kind of mermaid work and the crossover and stuff, like it's similarities with like intense training, really regimented training, being prepared to kind of, you know, figure things out on the go, borderline wrestle turtles at some point as well, probably. I swim with giant green sea turtles and I've hit my head off one, and you know, it's kind of, you've got to quickly get it together and figure out, because you're underwater, like you need to just get on with it. And that's something I'm good at. And then obviously like the sheer intensity of the aftermath as well, and that you are sore, you're tired, you're aching, everything hurts. And I deal with all that quite well, but yeah, I don't know. Have a bit of an apprehension to leave my feet. So, but you know, who knows? Like I said, I struggle to say no to opportunities. So you never know what could happen, but as it stands, I can't see it being in the immediate future, maybe.
Fair enough. So we talked about Rhea Ripley. I've just got Rhea in my head. Rhea Ripley being obviously one of your favourites. Since you've been involved in the wrestling side of things, who's in there? Who's your top, your fave five, or who's the people that you watch the most?
In general, or just like within the like UK scene or Scottish scene, or
just your fandom, just your, what you, who you fans of, who do you enjoy? Just you can make it as general or as rigid as possible when it comes to categories.
Oh, it's a hard one. I'm trying to think who do I. Okay, it's gonna be a mix. It's gonna be quite the mix. So obviously, Rhea Ripley's one. Love Rhea Ripley, I really, really do. I love Okada from New Japan. Well, he's not in New Japan, he's in AEW, but Okada's magnificent coats, outfits, everything. Love Okada. I think I love watching him in the ring. I just think he's generally very entertaining, probably definitely in my top five. I would have to say Abaddon. I really enjoy Abaddon's work. I love their character work. I love their inspiration. They're inspired by a lot of like Visual K kind of things, which is like a big Japanese fashion. So yeah, I really like that for them. And then, throw in a classic, Stone Cold. I'm a big Stone Cold fan. you only have to look at my partner to probably know that. I just really enjoy Stone Cold in general. And the last one would probably be Gold Dust. I really like Gold Dust. And I like, I like all the eras of Gold Dust as well. I'm a big fan of that. So I don't know what that says about me as that being my top five, but...
I think that just goes to show the variety of wrestling that I think you give people a million guesses, they probably wouldn't have got settled on that as five. But yeah,
I guess that says a lot about me though. I enjoy a good variety of things. So I am like I don't really tend to like to go down into one niche pigeonhole thing when it comes to like a broader thing like wrestling. You know, I enjoy different elements of different things. That's what makes it special, is it is so varied and it's great.
That's it. And it's a thing you could be as creative about as well. So you mentioned Rabu a couple of times. I've mentioned him a couple of times now. Casino Brutal, possibly one of my favorite teams going right now because of their creativity. Speaking of creativity, segue, I'm a pro now. So when it comes to that sort of thing, have you got some input? Does Rabu bounce self ideas to you, whether it, because I think I remember speaking to the guys recently, and it seems to be he has to wind down Mikey a lot for ideas. But are you the testing pool for these sorts of things?
A lot of the times, yeah. So I do help out sometimes with their promos and filming things and editing. I'm sure hopefully he won't mind me saying that. My kind of, you know, I do a lot of filming work and editing work and things like that. So I do help out in that kind of sense, but it is Rabu with all the ideas and his, you know, ever growing list of notes on his phone where things come to him in the night. And funny enough, we were actually just organizing one today where I had to send a really dubious voice note to one of my good friends and be like, hi, can we come to your shop and do X, Y, and Z? And she's just come back. She's like, this is the best voice note I've ever received. he kind of will like sound things off of me. And it's just more a case of like, we'll both sit there and like paint the picture in our heads. And then, you know, he just comes out with these amazing ideas and he's just, you know, naturally hilarious. And so is Mikey. Like I know obviously I'm somewhat biased, but I do really think the pair of them are just absolutely great together and they're so funny.
I mean, the fact that one of the promos, I think it was for Eric Young coming, the fact that my face was on that guest who board meant that I just had to think that they had to print off two pictures of my face at some point. That's just a weird concept in my brain. And anyway, again, we're on the Katt Wolfe podcast. So going forward,
the Eric Young promo was great, though. I enjoyed that a lot.
He tagged me in it, and I was watching it. Just going, hang on, what am I doing there?
We still have the guess who. Actually, we should probably play that at some point. It'd be a really interesting game of guess who.
going forward, then, as we kind of career towards a wrap up point, I suppose. You're a couple of years into wrestling, you've watched, you've been in front of some big crowds, you've been on TV, you've done all the, you've ticked a lot of boxes that someone that ring announcing or interviewing will have been able to tick. Is there a goal? Is there an end game? Something you want to once you've ticked off, go, okay, that's fine. Everything else is a bonus going forward.
I don't really know. It's hard to say. I've had a background in burlesque, when I was a burlesque performer, I really had this kind of regimented list of things I wanted to do. And when I finished that list, I actually retired from it and stopped doing it. But that was more a case of that I wanted to stop doing it. Whereas I just really love so many different things about wrestling. I love the community. I love the fans. I love, you know, the people I get to work with. I love the shows. I love the creativity. There's all these different elements that I can't really see myself getting bored of it. And there's always so many new people and things coming through as well. It's like, it's a very exciting kind of thing to be a part of. Whereas like, you know, burlesque kind of ended up getting quite stale quite fast because it just was very samey and it didn't really have that same buzz to it. So I don't know. I think I'm incredibly grateful and I've been very, very lucky for the opportunities that I've got up to this point. So I guess it's just one of those things to just keep on going and see what happens, really. And yeah, like I said, if, you know, when opportunities come to my doorstep, I find it hard to say no. So I guess it's one of those ones where I just keep trying my best and putting my best work out there and seeing what falls on my doorstep, really.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me today.
We
have barely scratched the surface. I mean, you mentioned things that, again, worlds that I'm not really okay with when it comes to like burlesque and all that kind of stuff. I'm sure we could probably spend another hour just yeah. going into all of that, and I will look very confused at the end of it, but entertained nonetheless. But before we go, social media, get all that all plugged. Where can people find out more about Katt Wolfe?
You can find me on Instagram at katt.wolf. I'm not on Twitter. And you can find me on TikTok at The Tattooed Mermaid.
Fantastic. Perfect. Well, again, yeah, thank you very much. This has been barely scratched the surface of Katt Wolfe, but people go to social media, they're sure to find out more and be just as fascinated as I have been. That's why I wanted you on the show, because just seeing your Instagram in general, just all the things that the rodeo, we didn't even get into that.
We didn't even talk about the rodeo, yeah. Every Wednesday, yeah. 8 till 11, Maggie Mays, you can come and find me.
There you go.
Commentating on rodeo riding. There you go. That is something I can commentate on. Wrestling, no. Rodeo, yes.
There we go. I'd get the plug in for that as well. But yeah.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me.
No problem. Thank you.